And our leaders said, the Lord bless everyone in Jesus' name. Father, we thank you for leadership development. Thank you for your people. We're asking, Lord, that your word will penetrate every life tonight in Jesus' name. Wake us up. I will pray that whatever we're forgetting, you remind us in Jesus' name. Thank you, Lord, for helping us to keep on contending earnestly for the faith once delivered unto the saints. We will not compromise. We will not let down. We'll not go back. We'll not give up. We'll keep on standing on your word in Jesus' name. Open our eyes of understanding tonight again. In Jesus' mighty name we pray. We're reading from Philippians chapter 4. And I'm reading from verse 5. Philippians chapter 4. Reading from verse 5. Let your moderation be known unto all men. The Lord is at hand. He gives us a statement of the imminence of the return of the Lord, the nearness of the return of the Lord. And as we're preparing for the coming of the Lord, and we're looking forward to that great event through the rapture, it says we should let our moderation be known unto all men. And the reason for that is because the coming of the Lord is very near. We're nearer the coming of the Lord than the Jewish people. We're nearer the coming of the Lord than the first century Christians. We're nearer the coming of the Lord than Peter, Paul, and all the other apostles, and all the members of the early church. And because we're so near, it says our mind should not be occupied with the things of this world. We should let our moderation be known unto all men. In 1 Peter chapter 4, I'm reading from verse 7. 1 Peter chapter 4, reading from verse 7. But the end of all things is at hand. Be ye therefore sober and watch unto prayer. Again, the apostle is telling us here, Apostle Peter, he says, the coming of the Lord is very near. The end of all things is at hand. Because of that, he says, we should make sure that we're sober-minded, and we're watchful unto prayer. Again, he's still reminding us that it's necessary, as we think about the coming of the Lord, that we will be moderate in all things. 1 Corinthians chapter 7. I read here from verse 29. 1 Corinthians chapter 7, reading from verse 29. It says, but this I say, brethren, the time is short. You see the revelation of the word of God, everyone reminding us the time is short, the end is at hand. The coming of the Lord is very near, is imminent, it will happen very soon. And because of that, in that verse 29, it remaineth that both they that have wives be as though they had none. It says we shouldn't be carried away by any pleasure, carried away by any excitement, carried away by any enjoyment, because the coming of the Lord is very near. And our heart, our mind should be in preparation for the coming of the Lord. In verse 30, that they that weep as though they wept not. Whatever the sorrow, whatever the pressure, whatever the pain, we shouldn't allow that to bog us down and to tie us down. It says, those who have wept or those who are weeping, as if there is nothing to weep about. And it says, and they that rejoice as though they rejoice not. It's telling us about moderation. You are rejoicing as if you are not rejoicing. You are weeping as if you are not weeping. As somebody died, are you bereaved? You are not overwhelmed and you are not overtaken by sorrow and by weeping. You'll be moderate in your thinking about those who have departed. Are you rejoicing? Something good has happened in your life. Something good has happened in your family. And because of that, you are rejoicing. Don't be carried away. It says we should moderate everything. And it says, they that buy as though they possess none. you're rich and you have things that money will buy. It says you shouldn't be carried away by that. It's telling us that in all things, at all times, there should be moderation in our lives. It tells us in verse 31, and they that use this world as not abusing it. You're using the things of the world. Use them as instruments to make you fulfill the will of God. But you are not abusing them. You are not drunk with them. You are not addicted to them. You are not totally immersed in them. As not abusing it, for the fashion of this world passes away. That is all the things we see and all the things we use, they are passing away. Look at verse 35. And this I speak for your own profit. Moderation, that's for your own profit. Weeping as, and then acting as if there's nothing to weep about, that's for your own profit. Rejoicing and then as if there is nothing to rejoice about, that's for your own profit. And you have the things of this world, and yet you use them moderately. You are not carried away because of the pleasure and because of the excitement. This I say and this I speak for your own profit, not that I may cast a snare upon you, but that that which is comely, that she may attend upon the Lord without distraction. That she may attend upon the Lord without distraction. Your possession should not distract you from the Lord. Your pleasure should not distract you from the Lord. The pain, the persecution, the trouble, the trial should not distract you from the Lord. And the things that pinch you, the things that pain you, and the things that come like pressure upon your life should not make you to deviate from the calling of the Lord upon your life. This I say, and about this moderation in all things in your life, so that you will not have any distraction. Tonight, we're looking at the message, the end time virtue of moderation in all things. The end time virtue of moderation in all things. All those things of the world, all the physical, all the natural, all the social, all the things that we can see on the outside, we shouldn't allow that to be the number one in our heart, in our life, to take away our heart from the Lord. There should be the end time virtue of moderation in all things. Three things we're looking at. Number one, the timeless commandment of moderation in ambition. The timeless commandment of moderation in ambition. Point number two, our true conviction and modesty of apparel. A true conviction, a Christian should have conviction. A believer should have conviction. And the ministers of the gospel should have conviction. And those who are called to take the gospel into all the world, there should be the number one thing in our lives. There should be a priority of our lives that there is true conviction and modesty of apparel, according to the scriptures. Number three now, total consecration for the mantle of the anointed. Total consecration for the mantle of the anointed. Actually, the thing that should concern us is the spiritual clothing of a minister, the spiritual mantle on a minister, and the spiritual apparel of a minister. We should think less of, you know, the things we wear, the things we put on, and all that, and let the mantle of power, the mantle of the Holy Ghost, the mantle of the anointed, be the things we're committed to, we're consecrated to, we're pursuing, we're searching for, we're possessing, and we wear that so that everywhere we go, with that mantle of the anointed, will do exploits for the Lord. It will be so in our lives in Jesus' name. Number one now, the timeless commandment of moderation in ambition. Ambition is very strong in many people's lives. I want to be this, I want to be there. And I want to go here, I want to go there, I want to achieve this, I want to possess that, I want to be richer than my parents, I want to be higher than the people I have known, I want to be number one, I want to be head, I don't want to be tail. The ambition can so consume us that we forget ourselves. The timeless commandment of moderation in ambition. We're coming to that, Philippians chapter 4 again, and I'm reading from verse 5. Let your moderation be known. Let your moderation be known. It's not like you are going about and you're saying, see me, I'm moderate. In dressing, I'm moderate. In appearance, I'm moderate. In everything I do, I'm moderate. In what I eat, in what I drink, I'm moderate. Come and watch how we do wedding for my children. I'm moderate. And come and see how we do a burial ceremony for my lost, the ones who have died, departed. I am moderate. Why not announce anything? Just by carrying it out. And just by doing it, let your moderation be known unto all men. Unto all men unbelievers, all men believers, all men members of our church, that you as a leader and you as a preacher or you as an overseer, you will lead the example. It's not that you are doing something that you are writing everywhere and you are sending information everywhere. Somebody must travel from far away. Somebody must jump in the plane and come and attend this particular ceremony. Let your moderation be known unto all men, unto believers like yourself, unto unbelievers who are not children of God, and they are watching your life, what you have been preaching, how you have been living. Now that this event is coming, we're going to see how you are going to comport yourself. Let your moderation be known unto all men. There are people that will challenge you. There are people that will question you. Why are you not doing it this way? Why are you not doing it that way? Why are you not washing this one? Why are you not celebrating this one? Those are the people that ought to see that by the grace of God, your moderation is known unto them. That will take conviction that you're not carried away because of the things you're doing and what is going on in your life. By the way, when people are not moderate in their lives, they are not moderate in ambition, they are not moderate in advancement, they are not moderate in promotion, they are not moderate in publicizing themselves, what's the real issue? What's the real problem? They want to impress somebody other than God. They want to impress society apart from impressing God. That's why he's telling us that we should be moderate in ambition. Let's say the one that many people are copying, we're looking at Isaiah chapter 14. Isaiah chapter 14, I'm reading from verse 12. Isaiah chapter 14, verse 12. How art thou fallen from heaven, O Lucifer, son of the morning? How art thou cut down to the ground, which didst weaken the nations? Thou hast said in thine heart, I will ascend into heaven. That's ambition. I will exalt my throne above the stars of God. That's ambition. I will sit also upon the mount of the congregation. That's the ambition. In the sides of the north, I will ascend above the heights of the clouds. That's the ambition. And the Lord is telling us that we shouldn't be like Lucifer. Not be like Satan, not exalt ourselves. I want to be above everyone, above everywhere. I want to be this, I want to be that. I want to enter into the books of who and who in this world. It says that was the ambition of Satan, of Lucifer, and that is why he fell. And don't be like him, be moderate in your ambition. Verse 14, our ascent. Above the heights of the clouds, I will be like the Most High, yet thou shalt be brought down to hell, and to the sides of the pit. It says in verse 16, they that see thee shall narrowly look upon thee and consider thee, saying, is this the man? Is this the person? Is this the identity of the person that made the earth to tremble, that did shake the kingdoms, that made the world as a wilderness and destroyed the cities thereof, that opened not the house of his prisoners? It says, not have the heart or the mind, the ambition or the goal of the devil, of Lucifer, be moderate in all things. Actually, what caused the fall is because there was lack of moderation in all things. In Genesis chapter 3, reading there from verse 1, now the serpent was more subtle than any beast of the field which the Lord God had made. Satan, or Lucifer, had fallen. He had become Satan. And now he entered into the life, into the heart of the serpent. And through the serpent, he now spoke to Eve. Again, it's ambition. It's ambition. Look at it in verse 1 there. Yea, as God said, ye shall not eat of every tree of the garden. And the woman said unto the serpent, we may eat of the fruit of the trees of the garden, but of the fruit of the tree which is in the midst of the garden, the Lord God hath said, ye shall not eat of it, neither shall ye touch it, lest ye die. She replied well. She knew it well before ambition came, before Satan tempted her to say, are you right the way you are? Don't want to go higher and become greater and be in a position higher than you ever knew, ambition. And the serpent said unto the woman, ye shall not surely die, for God does know that in the day ye eat thereof, then your eyes shall be opened, and ye shall be as gods, knowing good and evil. That's the ambition. Ye shall be as gods. You don't want to remain at the level you are now. They were perfect, there was no sin, and they were made in the image of God, in likeness of God. But that now will not satisfy an ambitious heart that wants to be like God, like the gods. You know the story. Look at verse 6. And when the woman saw that the tree was good for food, and that it was pleasant to the eyes, and a tree to be desired to make one wise, she took of the fruit thereof, and did eat, and gave also to her husband with her, and he did eat. It was ambition that brought her down, and that passed the whole of humanity. Sin came through the woman and then through the man, and eventually all their offsprings became sinful, and they had the sinful nature. They were driven out of the garden of Eden, and if they died in that condition, all their descendants died in that condition, they would have, the whole of humanity would have perished. But God sent a redeemer. The point is, don't be carried away with ambition. Be satisfied with what you have. Let your moderation of achievement, moderation in ambition, moderation in accomplishment, let it be known unto all men. We're looking at Genesis chapter 11. Genesis chapter 11. I'm reading here from verse 3. And they said one to another, go to, let us make brick and burn them thoroughly. And they had brick for stone, and slime that they had for mortar. And they said, go to, let us build us a city and a tower whose top may reach unto heaven. That's ambition. That's ambition. Want to do what nobody else has done. We're uniting together and we're binding ourselves together so that we can do what others have not done. They had one language, they wanted to use that to their own advantage. And it says, and let us make us a name, let us make us a name. That's the ambition. And the Lord is telling us, be moderate in all things. Be satisfied, be content with what you have. Lest we be scattered abroad upon the face of the whole earth. That's exactly what the Lord wanted. He wanted them to fill the whole earth. But he said, lest we should obey God and please God and then be scattered everywhere. Let us make a name for ourselves. And the Lord came down to see the city and the tower which the children of men builded. And the Lord said, behold, the people is one, and they have all one language, and this they begin to do. And now nothing will be restrained from them which they have imagined to do. Go to, let us go down and there confound their language, that they may not understand one another's speech. What caused that? Ambition. Ambition. They would have remained in the favor of God, but ambition, ambition scattered them. In Exodus chapter 15, I'm reading from verse 9. Exodus chapter 15, we're reading here from verse 9. The enemy said, I will pursue, I will overtake, I will divide the spoil. My loss shall be satisfied upon them. I will draw my sword. My hand shall destroy them. You see that ambition? He had allowed the children of Israel to go. And after they departed, then he said, why did we do that? We need to get to them. If we cannot get them and get them back as slaves, will kill them, will destroy them, will slay them. And that's why he pursued. Thou didst blow with thy wind, the sea covered them, they sank as lead in the mighty waters. Who is like unto thee, O Lord, among the gods? Who is like thee, glorious in holiness and fearful in praises, doing wonders? Thou stretched out thy right hand, they have swallowed them. Thou in thy mercy hast led forth the people which thou hast redeemed. Thou hast guided them in thy strength unto thy holy habitation. Those Egyptians perished because of ambition. Ambition. We're coming to 2 Samuel chapter 15. 2 Samuel chapter 15, the timeless commandment of the Lord, let your moderation be known unto all men. Your moderation in everything, your moderation from your own heart, let it be known to you. Your moderation, your pursuit, let it be known even to your family, that you are not somebody just, I want this, I want this, I want this, and you forget that the time of the coming of the Lord is at hand, and you need to prepare, spend some of your time, some of your energy, and some of your intelligence preparing for the coming of the Lord, which is very near, rather than all this ambition, ambition. I must be there, I must have that, I must possess that, I must take that one. Let your moderation be known unto all men. We're looking at 2 Samuel chapter 15. 2 Samuel chapter 15. I'm reading here from verse 1. And it came to pass after this that Absalom prepared him chariots and horses and 50 men to run before him. And Absalom rose up early and stood beside the way of the gate. And it was so that when any man that had a controversy came to the king for judgment, then Absalom called unto him and said, of what city art thou? And he said, thy servant is of one of the tribes of Israel. And Absalom said unto him, here is ambition, here is ambition. See, thy matters are good and right, But there is no man deputed of the king to hear thee. Absalom said, moreover, oh, that I were made judge in the land, that every man, which has any suit or cause might come unto me, and I would do him justice. That's ambition. Oh, that I will be that. Oh, that I will be this. Oh, that I will go beyond everyone and possess, have the power to control the lives of all the people. And it was so that when any man came near to him to do him obeisance, he put forth his hand and took him and kissed him. And on this manner did Absalom to all Israel. On this manner, ambition, he'll wake up early in the morning to resume. And then he will stay up late at night so that he can get the people until the people stop coming at night. Then he will retire. But it was ambition that ruined him. Ambition that destroyed him. In this manner, Absalom did to all Israel that came to the king for judgment. So Absalom stole the hearts of the men of Israel. You know his story. And you know the end of that man. Eventually, we're looking at chapter 18, 2 Samuel chapter 18. I'm reading here from verse 9. 2 Samuel chapter 18, and we're reading from verse 9. Be moderate in ambition. Be satisfied with what you have, and be content or contented with what you have. He's giving us so much, he's done so much for us. And instead of following after Lucifer, after Absalom, after the people that built a Babel, I want to be this, I want to be that, let your moderation be known unto all men. The Lord is at hand. Look at the end of this man, Absalom. In 2 Samuel chapter 18, reading here from verse 9. And Absalom met the servants of David, and Absalom rode upon a mule. And the mule went under the thick boughs of a great oak, and his head caught hold of the oak, and he was taken up between heaven, the heaven and the earth. And the mule that was under him went away. He was hanging there in one of the branches of the tree. And a certain man saw it and told Joab and said, behold, I saw Absalom hang in an oak. I saw him. He didn't do anything. But then you come to verse 15. And 10 young men that bear Joab's armor compassed about and smote Absalom and slew him. He died unnecessarily. But ambition killed him. Ambition killed him. He could have been alive, but ambition will not allow him to stay alive. We're looking at Ecclesiastes chapter 5. I read verse 10. Ecclesiastes chapter 5, reading from verse 10. Let your moderation be known unto all men. Are you seeking some of the things of this world? Be moderate. Be moderate. Those things, if you're too pressured, seeking for them, might you lose your life unnecessarily. You might lose your spiritual life too. You might backslide because of the search for the things that your heart is running after. Ecclesiastes chapter 5 verse 10. He that loveth silver shall not be satisfied with silver. Once you set your mind on something, I want it, you are praying about it, you are fasting about it, you are talking about it, and you are going everywhere. Anybody you are talking to, that's what you are putting forward every time. You love that thing so much, even when you get that, you'll not be satisfied. You want more, you want more, you want more. And you forget the commandment of the Lord. Let your moderation be known unto all men. The Lord is at hand. It says, he that loveth silver shall not be satisfied with silver, nor he that loveth abundance with increase. This also is vanity. That's what we're told in 1 Timothy chapter 6. 1 Timothy chapter 6. reading here from verse 6. 1 Timothy chapter 6, from verse 6. It says, but godliness with contentment is great gain. Godliness with moderation is great gain. With godliness with checking yourself, holding yourself back, not wanting everything, not saying, I want this, you've got something. Then you see another person having something better than you have, I must have that one. You have that one, you see another person that has something greater than what you've got now, you want that one again. It says, but godliness and with contentment, with moderation, is great gain. For we brought nothing into this world, and it is certain, it is sure, it is definite, we can carry nothing out. Having food and raiment, let us be therewith content. Moderation. In verse 9, but they that will be rich fall into temptation and a snare, and into many foolish and hurtful laws, which drown men in destruction and perdition. For the love of money is the root of all evil, which while some coveted after, they have erred from the faith and pierced themselves through with many sorrows. But thou, O man of God, thou, O child of God, but thou, O servant of God, flee these things, be moderate, be satisfied with what you have. It says over here that you flee these things and follow after righteousness, godliness, faith, love, patience, meekness. As the coming of the Lord is very near, what should we be pursuing? As the coming of the Lord is getting closer and closer, and we're nearer today than those in Bible days, what should we pursue? Righteousness. What should we pursue? Godliness, faith, love, patience, and meekness. That's what the Lord is calling us to, and that's what the Lord is telling us, and is saying we should be moderate in all things. We're looking at Hebrews chapter 13. I'm reading from verses 5 and 6. Let your conversation be without covetousness. Let your conversation be without this extra kind of ambition. Be without covetousness, and be content, be satisfied with such things as ye have. For he has said, I will never leave thee, nor forsake thee, so that we may boldly say, the Lord is my helper, I will not fear what man shall do unto me. Amen. Somebody help me shout, amen. 2 Peter chapter 3, and I'm reading from verse 10. 2 Peter chapter 3, we're looking at verse 10. It says, but the day of the Lord will come as a thief in the night, in the which the heavens shall pass away with a great noise, and the elements shall melt with fervent heat, and the earth also, and the works that are therein shall be burnt up. What's that saying? It's saying that all people are pursuing, all the things that people are possessing, I'll build that, I'll take that, I'll pursue that, I'll possess that, I will gain that. Everything will be burnt up. And the time is very near. Spend your life, spend your time on things that will not be burnt up. Your salvation, your sanctification, your godliness, your evangelism, your winning souls into the kingdom, your spending and being spent to make sure that people come into the kingdom. It says spend your life on that. All these other things are going to be burnt up. Look at verse 11. Seeing then that all these things shall be dissolved, what manner of persons ought ye to be in all holy conversation and godliness, looking for and hastening unto the coming of the day of God, wherein the heavens being on fire shall be dissolved, and the element shall melt with fervent heat. All the possessions of this world, all the pursuits of this world, everything will melt away. Nevertheless, we, according to his promise, look for new heavens and a new earth wherein dwelleth righteousness. Wherefore, beloved, seeing that ye look for such things, be diligent that ye may be found in him, of him, in peace, without spot and without blame, blameless. I pray God will give us the wisdom from on high to pursue things that are spiritual, and things that are eternal, and things that will last, things that cannot be burnt up by the fire, by the devastation that will come on the final day. God help us to be moderate in all things and at all times, in Jesus' name. We're coming back to Philippians chapter 4, and I'm reading from verse 5. Let your moderation be known unto all men. Let your moderation be known unto all men. Now he's talking to you in particular. As you think about yourself now, and you think about what people say about you, and when they see you in your outing, it may be like a wedding is taking place. There are some people, they don't even know who is wedding. They don't know, they have never met. They just say here announcement, wedding is going on there. They abandon everything. They must be there. There are some people, they can travel outside the country because somebody is having wedding somewhere. And there are other people, a burial is taking place, ceremony is taking place, a graduation is taking place, whatever, you'll find them everywhere. And then they abandon the work of the Lord that they should do. They might even take time off and they wait for a long time. And then when you see them later, where have you been? Actually, somebody was celebrating. And you know, we need to rejoice with those who are rejoicing. And I needed to take time off. Meanwhile, souls are perishing. And it says, let your moderation be known unto all men. Amen. The Lord is at hand. The true conviction and modesty of apparel. Our true conviction. What's our conviction today? And what is our conviction based on? Is our conviction based on the fleeting things of the world or the passing things of the world? What the other people are doing? Or look at my position now. Look at the place where God has placed me now. I'm not an ordinary person now in society. Is that the basis of your conviction? The conviction we have should be based on the word of God. Our true conviction and modesty of apparel. I'm reading from 1 Peter chapter 3. 1 Peter chapter 3. And I'm reading here from verse 3. 1 Peter chapter 3, verse 3. Whose adorning, let it not be the outward adorning of plaiting the hair and wearing of gold and putting on of apparel. Here the apostle is telling us a concentration, a commitment will not be on, you know, my hairdo, my hairstyle. Not only men, not only women, men and women, that we're not going after the fashion of the world. I must have it this way and have it that way. Yes, you'll be clean. Yes, you'll be neat, but you'll not be worldly. The wearing of gold or the putting on of apparel. But let it be the hidden man of the heart in that which is not corruptible. Hidden man of the heart. You take care of your spiritual life more than your facial appearance, more than how your lips look, more than how your ear looks, and more than this and that. You're not checking up on the internet. I'm checking up this, I'm checking up this. And my look will be like this, and my look will be like that. I've heard of another sin. Once you take that sin, you'll be much, much younger. You look much, much younger. Well, never mind. All the internal organs are still as old as they are. Only the facial appearance that you try to brighten up and smoothen up. It says, don't be like that. Think about your spiritual life, the inner man and the inward man. It says, let it be the hidden man of the heart in that which is not corruptible. Even the ornament of a meek and quiet spirit, not noisy, not flippant, not frivolous, and not, you know, the shouting type, the meek and the quiet spirit, which in the sight of God is of great price. For after this manner, in the old time, holy women, righteous women, sanctified women, godly women also, who trusted in God, adorned themselves in a virtue, spiritual virtue, and glorious godly virtue, being in subjection to their own husbands, even as Sarah obeyed Abraham, calling him Lord. It's not just the, you know, the calling Lord, Lord, but it's the submission in the heart, it's the humility in the heart, it's the moderation in the heart. Whose daughters ye are, as long as ye do well, do well, do well, do well in life, do well to the needy, do well to the poor. Don't spend all your possession, all your treasure on, you know, kind of apparel and things like that. Let's take care of the poor. Let's take care of the people that are needy around us. You do well and are not afraid with any amazement. Let's come back to Genesis. We're looking at Genesis chapter 35. Genesis chapter 35, I read from verse 1. Genesis chapter 35, verse 1. And God said unto Jacob, arise, go up to Bethel and dwell there. Go up to Bethel, the house of God, and dwell there. Go up to Bethel, the place of my choice, and get there and make there an altar unto God that appeared unto thee when thou fleddest from the face of Esau thy brother. Then Jacob said unto his household and to all that were with him, put away the strange gods that are among you. Jacob knew that those strange gods were there and did nothing about that. Jacob knew that there was something the hearts of the members of his family were pursuing every time. It became gods to them, became idols to them, and they were more important than family altar, more important than the word of the husband, more important than the calling of God upon the life of Jacob. He knew it, he did nothing. But now he said, put away the strange gods that are among you and be clean and change your garments. And change your garments. He knew that there were things they were wearing they shouldn't be wearing, and it will not go well to go with them to Bethel. And he said, we're going to Bethel, we're going to the house of God, we're going to be living there, we're going to stay there. Change your garments and let us arise and go up to Bethel, and I will make there an altar unto God who appeared, who answered me in the day of my distress and was with me in the way which I went. And they gave unto Jacob all the strange gods, all the strange gods. Any strange god in your life? Any strange god in your heart? Anything that your heart is after? Anything that you're saying, this must be part of me. If God requires this one, it will be a battle. It will be a struggle for me to give up. Is there anything in your life that is difficult to give up, even when the Lord is demanding? That thing has become a god. And then it says, and the strange gods which were in their hand, and all the earrings that were in their ears. Jacob did not mention that, but he knew it had become a god. Jacob, from the people that argue and the word of God only says it's moderation on a jewelry, moderation on earring, moderation on chain, moderation on this and that. Jacob, if the Lord spoke to them directly, would they be able to give it up? It will be a struggle. It has become an idol in the lives of many people. And we're told Jacob hid them under the oak, which was by Shechem. And they journeyed, And the terror of God was upon the cities that were round about them, and they did not pursue after the sons of Jacob. Deuteronomy chapter 22, I'm reading from verse 5. Deuteronomy chapter 22, we're looking at verse 5. The woman shall not wear that which pertaineth unto a man, neither shall a man put on a woman's garment, for all that do so are abomination unto the Lord thy God. If you read this verse to the average person outside there, oh, they will say it has Old Testament. Old Testament, and it will remind you, you know, when the commandment, when the new covenant came, it canceled the old covenant, and everything they write here, as it says now, the woman shall not wear that which pertaineth unto a man, that one is already abolished, and we can wear anything now. Look at the whole verse, look at the second part of the verse. Neither shall a man put on a woman's garment. Neither shall a man put on a woman's garment. That's the second part. All those places, whether church or assembly, anywhere, if a man appears in their presence and he appears with the costume or the dressing of a woman, they'll be looking at him strange. What came on you? What are you doing? You are a man and you are putting on scarf. You are a man and you are wearing blouse. You are a man and you are wearing up and down. You are a man and you are wearing this and that. They will frown at it. But it's in the same verse. If it is wrong for a man to put on a woman's dress, then it is wrong for a woman to put on a man's dress. Both sides of the coin are in the same verse. Look at that again. The woman shall not wear that which pertaineth unto a man, neither shall a man put on a woman's garment, for all that do so, men that wear women's garment, or that make their ear dear like that of the women, all that do so, and women that wear men's apparel, it says their abomination unto the Lord thy God. I pray you will not be an abomination. I will not be an abomination. Look at Zephaniah chapter 1. Zephaniah chapter 1. I'm reading from verse 8. Zephaniah chapter 1. We're looking at verse 8. It says, and it shall come to pass in the day of the Lord's sacrifice that I will punish the princes and the king's children and all such as are clothed with strange apparel. With strange apparel. Strange to the word of God. Strange to the eyes of God. Strange to the standard of the word of God. God himself said, I will punish all those children. I will punish even the princes. I will punish even the king's children and everyone else because of their position in society and because of the family they belong to. You cannot correct them. And because their parents are protecting them. Leave my child, leave my child. Leave him like that. Leave her like that. She's good enough for me. If you don't want us in your church, then we'll find another church. They don't appreciate sound doctrine. They don't appreciate salvation. They don't appreciate holiness, without which no man shall save the Lord. Any little sin, they will threaten the pastor. They will threaten the leaders in the church. It's becoming too much, you know, do this, don't eat this, don't go there, don't go there. If it's too much, there are many other churches, and we will go away to another church. And then those pastors, it's okay, but don't go, remain there. Even though you are not keeping to the word of God, remain there. Even though you don't have any conviction, remain there. Even though you are a troublemaker while you're here, remain there. Even though you are scattering the church, church while you are there, remain there, and they are not moving forward, and the people that want to move forward, you'll not allow them to move, but God will punish all that are clothed with strange apparel. Look at verse 9. In the same day also will I punish all those that live on the threshold, which fill their master's houses with violence and deceit. We're coming to Isaiah chapter 3. Isaiah chapter 3, this is what God says he will do. And this is what the Lord tells us in these passages. Actually, the Old Testament people did not have as much grace as the New Testament people. If the people that didn't have much grace as we have, they didn't have much knowledge as we have, they didn't have more commitment as we have, and they didn't have the atonement of Jesus Christ to depend on as we have, if God will punish the people that didn't have sufficient grace or enough grace or as much grace as we have, we who have greater grace, greater strength, greater knowledge, greater understanding, if we do the same thing that they did, if he will punish the people with less grace, he'll punish the people with greater grace. Isaiah chapter 3, and I'm reading from verse 16. Isaiah chapter 3, verse 16. Moreover, the Lord says, this is not Isaiah, this is the Lord. Moreover, the Lord says, because the daughters of Zion are haughty, and they walk with stretched forth necks and wanton eyes, walking and mincing as they go to attract attention. They want to distract the attention of the people away from God unto themselves. They want to become little goddesses. It says, I'm making a tinkling with their feet. Therefore, the Lord, not man, the Lord, not Isaiah, the Lord, not the preacher, the Lord, not the leader in the church, but the Lord will smite with a scar the crown of the head of the daughters of Zion. Daughters of Zion. And the Lord will discover the secret parts. In that day, the Lord will take away. Notice, is the Lord, is the Lord, is the judgment of the Lord, is the discipline of the Lord. It is punishment coming from the Lord. In that day, the Lord will take away the bravery of their tinkling ornaments. He bowed their feet and their curls and their surround tires like the moon, the chains and the bracelets and the mufflers and the bonnets and the ornaments of the legs. They even put, instead of just putting the earring, the gold in the ear, and hanging a chain on the neck, they also have chains around their ankle, and they also have the rings in their toes. Think about that. That they just, anywhere they can put it, they want to put the jewelry there, and they can even punch holes in the nose and have it there. They must saturate everywhere and hang all those things in every part of the body. And since so-and-so is doing it, a footballer is doing it, a Hollywood somebody is doing it, and the entertainers are doing it, and the television experts doing it, and therefore we're going to do it. If we see it all over the world, if we see it on the billboard, if we see it on the television, if we see it in their games, anywhere we see it, that's the thing to copy. They are not following the Bible, they are following the people that do not know the place they are going. And the Lord said he will bring a judgment upon them. I pray you'll not be under the judgment of God in Jesus' name. It says in verse 20, the bonnets and the ornaments of the legs and the headbands and the tablets and the earrings. And then he goes on, and the rings and the nose jewels and the changeable suits of apparel and the mantles and the wimples and the crisping pins and the glasses and the fine linen and the hoods and the veils. And it shall come to pass, instead of sweet smell, there shall be a sting. And instead of girdle, a wrench. Instead of well-set ear, boldness. And instead of a stomacher, it says a garden of sackcloth and burning. Instead of beauty, The Lord deliver his church. The Lord deliver our women. The Lord deliver our youths. The Lord deliver the whole church from compromise in Jesus' name. We're looking at 1 Timothy chapter 2. I'm reading from verse 9. 1 Timothy chapter 2. We're reading from verse 9. In 1 Timothy chapter 2 verse 9, in like manner also, that women adorn themselves in modest apparel. As you think about what Paul the Apostle has written, he wrote to the Gentile church, is primarily an apostle to the Gentiles. And even the children of Israel, Peter, writing to those who are scattered abroad, writing to the children of Israel, he mentioned the same thing. But he didn't have to explain too much because those people, they knew their Old Testament. He just touched on it. But these Gentiles that have gone beyond, they've gone beyond anything you could think about. Paul the Apostle now told them, you come out from that saturated kind of appearance and you become simple and you become meek. And he says, all the women adorn themselves with modest apparel, with shamefacedness and sobriety. That is, there should be something that shows that you have shamefacedness, you are humble, you are hiding, you are not showy, you are not exposing everything that ought to be covered. It says there is a shamefacedness and sobriety, not with broidered hair or gold or pearls or costly array, but which becometh women professing godliness with good works. Let the women learn, don't argue, let the women learn in silence with all subjection. Look at verse 15. Notwithstanding, she shall be saved in childbearing if they continue. Husband and wife, if they continue, the women, the aged and the young ones, if they continue in faith and charity and holiness with sobriety, we will continue. These things will not make us give up the faith in Jesus' name. Judges, I'm reading from chapter 8. Judges chapter 8, I'm reading from verse 22. Then the men of Israel said unto Gideon, rule thou over us, but thou and thy son and thy son's sons also, for thou hast delivered us from the hand of Midian. Verse 23, and Gideon said unto them, I will not rule over you, neither shall my son rule over you. The Lord shall rule over you. Great, wonderful. But look at this now, verse 24. And Gideon said unto them, I would desire a request of you, that ye would give me every man the earrings of his prey. Look at the explanation. For they had golden earrings because they were Ishmaelites. If they didn't put that there, well, think, you know, it's a common thing. Everybody has it. Everybody uses it. It says, because they were Ishmaelites. And Gideon said, give me those earrings. And they answered, well, willingly give them. And they spread a garment and did cast therein every man the earring of his prey. And the weight of the golden earrings that he requested was 1,700 shekels of gold, besides ornaments and collars and purple raiment that was on the kings of Midian, and besides the chains that were about their camels' necks. Those people decorated also their camels and their horses. And Gideon made an effort thereof, and put it in a city, even in Ophrah. And all Israel went thither a warring after it, and the sin became a snare unto Gideon and to his house. a humble person, a committed person, a consecrated person that said, I will not reign over you. My sons, my children will not reign over you. The Lord will reign over you. Eventually, all the things that he saw in those Ishmaelites and the gold and the earrings made him to go astray. I will not go astray. You're not to look at the things of the world and the people of the world, and then they're drawing your heart away by their dressing. They're drawing your heart away by their outlook. They're drawing your heart away by their apparel and the appearance they have. Your heart will not be secretly drawn away in Jesus' name. Psalm 73, I'm reading here from verse 6. Psalm 73, we're looking at verse 6. Therefore, pride compasseth them about as a chain. They feel high. They feel great. They feel on top of the world because of what they put on. If they don't put on those things, somehow their self-esteem is affected. Somehow their personality is affected. Somehow the way they think about themselves is affected, because they prop up themselves by those things they put on. It says in verse 6, therefore pride compasseth them about as a chain. Violence covereth them as a garment. Their eyes stand out with fatness. They have more than their heart could wish. They are corrupt. They speak wickedly concerning oppression, and they speak loftily. They set their mouths against the heavens, and their tongue walketh through the earth. Therefore, his people return hither, and the waters of a full cup are wrung out to them. And they say, how does God know? How does God know? We live our lives, we're independent of God, and we're indifferent to whatever God may be saying in his word. How does God know? Is there knowledge in the Most High? Behold, these are ungodly who prosper in the world and increase in riches. Look at verse 16. When I thought to know this, it was too painful for me. You look at the people of the world, and you look at them contradicting and disobeying everything the word of God says, and yet it appears they are happy. It appears they are healthy. It appears everything is going well for them. And this man that wrote Psalm 73 said, when I thought to know this, it was too painful for me, until I went into the sanctuary of God. Then I understood their end. If you're looking at the present, if you're looking at the apparel, if you're looking at the decorations, if you're looking at the cosmetics, if you're looking at the way they appear, you'll be confused. They're happy. It appears everything around for them. They're religious too. And then it says, when I came now into the sanctuary, I understood their end. Surely, in verse 18, thou didst set them in sleepy praises, thou casted them down into destruction. How are they brought into desolation? As in a moment, they are utterly consumed with terrors, as a dream when one awaketh. So, O Lord, thou awakest, and thou shalt despise their image. Thus my heart was grieved. I was preached in my reign. So foolish was I and ignorant. I was as a beast before thee. Nevertheless, I'm continually with thee. Thou was holding me by thy right hand. Thou shalt guide me by with thy counsel, and afterward receive me to glory. Amen. Whom have I in heaven but thee? And there is none upon the earth that I desire beside thee. There's nobody I want to please. There's nobody I want to look, you know, this particular way, so that he will appreciate me or she will appreciate me. Whom have I in heaven but thee? And there is none upon the earth that I desire beside thee. My flesh and my heart faileth, but God is the strength of my heart and my portion forever. Who is your portion forever? I said, who is your portion forever? Jude chapter 1, only one chapter. I'm reading from verse 21. Jude, verse 21. Keep yourselves in the love of God. You see a lot of things in the world. You see a lot of things in the office. You see a lot of things everywhere. And some of them might attract you. That's temptation. Resist that temptation. Earnestly contending for the faith once delivered unto the saints throughout your life in Jesus' name. It's too late looking back. The Lord is about to come. All these years you have been faithful. You'll be faithful unto the very end in Jesus' name. Keep yourselves in the love of God, looking for that, looking for the mercy of our Lord Jesus Christ unto eternal life. And then it says, and of some have compassion, making a difference. You are evangelizing, and therefore it says you have compassion on them, and others save with fear. Others save with fear. Sinners are sinners, and they have what they have, and whatever they wear, we're not going to look at that. We are the people to have conviction and to say, here is where I stand. For the people who are just coming, for the people who are here, who are to hear the word of God, we don't clean the fish before we catch the fish. We catch the fish first, and then after that, as they continue listening to the word of God, we will speak the whole word of God to them. And then we're not going to compromise. But at the beginning, we're not going to try and clean the fish before catching the fish. But all the same, others save with fear, pulling them out of the fire, hating even the garments spotted by the flesh. The garments they wear that will lead to fleshly activity and will lead into temptation and will lead a man to fall and will lead a woman to fall. It says you hate the garments spotted by the flesh. Now unto him that is able, our God is able. I said our God is able. Unto him that is able to keep you from falling and to present you faultless before the presence of his glory with exceeding joy. To the only wise God, our Savior, be glory and majesty, dominion and power, both now and ever. Amen. Amen. Point number three now, total consecration. Total consecration for the mantle of the anointed. Actually, what's important for a minister, what's important for a child of God, is the anointing of the Lord, and the mantle of that anointing. That's what's important. We now that need to go out with the power of God, with the anointing that breaks every yoke, what are we running after? What should we be praying for? What should be the most important thing to us? Obviously, it's not the things that glitter in the world. Obviously, it is not the things that are attractive to the people of the world. It's the power of the Holy Ghost. It's the mantle of the anointed. And it is the power that will make us do everything the Lord has called us to do. Total consecration for the mantle of the anointed. We're looking at 2 Kings chapter 2. 2 Kings chapter 2, I'm reading from verse 8. In 2 Kings chapter 2, reading from verse 8, and Elijah took his mantle and wrapped it together and smote the waters, and they were divided, parted here and thither, so that they too went over on dry ground. And it came to pass, when they were gone over, that Elijah said unto Elisha, ask what I shall do for thee before I be taken away from thee. And Elisha said, I pray thee, let a double portion of thy spirit be upon me. That's the important thing to the minister. That's the essential thing for the minister. That's the pursuit of the minister. And that's why Elisha had consecrated himself. And then the Lord has sent me to Bethel. I will not leave you. As long as the God of heaven is alive, I'm not going to leave you. They went together. The Lord has sent me to Jordan. I will not leave you. And then they got there. And now he said, after this consecration, after this commitment, what do you want? What are you asking for? A double portion of thy spirit. You know the story. He got it. I will get it. We're looking at Acts of the Apostles, chapter 19. Acts of the Apostles, chapter 19. I'm reading from verse 11. This was important. This was important. Acts chapter 19, verse 11. And God wrought special miracles by the hand of Paul. Paul is gone. You are the one on stage today. My brother, you are the one we're looking up to. My dear sister, you are the one we're looking up to. That the dress you wear will carry so much of the power of God. You know, if it is worldly dressing, it will not carry the power of God. If it is sensual dressing, it will not cover, it will not have the power of God. If it is dressing to attract men and attract women in the world, it will not carry the power and the anointing. But it says God wrought special miracles by the hand of Paul, so that from his body were brought unto the sick handkerchiefs, our aprons, and the disease departed from them, and the evil spirits went out of them. And that's what's important, that the mantle you have will carry the power of God, and that your very life will carry the power of God. It will be so from tonight, if it was not so before, in Jesus' name. Power, anointing, the breaking of yoke, the kind of garment you wear that somebody can touch, and then every sin that is wrong with that person will totally vanish away. Isaiah chapter 52, verse 1, awake, awake, put on thy strength, O Zion, and put on the beautiful garments. That's the garment of righteousness, the garment of salvation, and the robe of righteousness. O Jerusalem, and the holy city, for henceforth there shall no more come into thee the uncircumcised or the unclean. Shake up thyself from the dust. Arise, sit down, O Jerusalem. Loose thyself from the bands of thy neck, O captive daughter of Zion. Every bondage is broken. Every power of the devil is broken. An anointing will come upon your life that will break every yoke in Jesus' name. Isaiah chapter 10, verse 27. Isaiah chapter 10, verse 27. And it shall come to pass in that day that his burden shall be taken away from off thy shoulder, and the yoke from off thy neck, and the yoke from off thy neck, and the yoke shall be destroyed. Every yoke in your life shall be destroyed. Every yoke in your family shall be destroyed. Every yoke around you shall be destroyed. And the yoke shall be destroyed because of the anointing. Because of the anointing. It will happen in Jesus' name. As I conclude, let me read this to you. In Esther chapter 6. Esther chapter 6. Esther chapter 6. I'm reading here from verse 6. A new garment, a new robe, a new apparel. Give me a good, good amen now. The Lord will dress you up. And when he dresses you up in this new garment, power will flow through your life in Jesus' name. Esther chapter 6, I'm reading from verse 6. So Haman came in, and the king said unto him, what shall be done unto the man whom the king delighteth to honor? The king delights to honor you. He will honor you. We'll see the honor in your life in Jesus' name. Now a man thought in his heart, to whom will the king delight to do honor more than to myself? And Haman answered the king, for the man whom the king delighted to honor, let the royal apparel be brought, which the king used to wear, and the horse that the king rideth upon, and the crown royal which is set upon his head. And let this apparel, royal apparel, the king's apparel, anointed apparel, special apparel, and the horse be delivered unto the hand of one of the king's most noble princes, that they may array the man with zeal whom the king delighted to honor, and bring him on the horseback through the streets of the city, and proclaim before him, thus shall it be done to the man whom the king delighteth to honor. Who does the king delight to honor today? He will honor you. I said he will honor you. With his own apparel, he will honor you. With the anointing that was on Christ, he will honor you. With the anointing that was on Paul the Apostle, he will honor you. With the mantle that came down from Elijah, he will honor you. Verse 10, and the king said to Haman, make haste, hurry up, and take the apparel and the horse, as thou hast said, and do even so to Mordecai the Jew. Your enemies will fall before you. That sitteth at the king's gate, let nothing fail of all that thou hast spoken. Then took Haman the apparel and the horse, and arrayed Mordecai, clothed Mordecai, and brought him on horseback through the streets of the city. And he proclaimed before him, thus shall it be done unto the man whom the king delighteth to honor. And Mordecai came again to the king's gate, but Haman hasted to his house mourning, and having his head covered. And Haman told Zeresh his wife, and all the child, the friends, every sin that had befallen him. Our enemies were fallen. Then said his wise men and Zeresh his wife unto him, if Mordecai be of the siege of the Jews before whom thou hast begun to fall, thou shalt not prevail against him, but shall surely fall before him. Let's look at chapter 8 of Esther. Esther chapter 8, I'm reading from verse 15. And Mordecai went out from the presence of the king in royal apparel. I'm looking at Mordecai there. I'm looking at the sister there. You'll go out in the dignity of the Lord, in the majesty of the Lord, in the anointed apparel of the Lord. And Mordecai went out from the presence of the king in royal apparel of blue and white, and with a great crown of gold, and with a garment of fine linen and purple. And the city of Shushan rejoiced and was glad. This church will rejoice because of you. And the Jews had light and gladness and joy and honor. And in every province and in every city, whithersoever the king's commandment and his decree came, the Jews had joy and gladness. A feast and a good day, and many of the people of the land became Jews, for the fear of the Jews fell upon them. Something is going to happen through you. Look at chapter 10, verse 3. For Mordecai the Jew was next to the king Ahasuerus, and great among the youths, and accepted of the multitude of his brethren, seeking the wealth of his people, and speaking of peace of all his seed. The blessing of the Lord come upon you. The glory of the Lord will clothe you like a garment. And the meekness and the humility in your life will be crowned with a great anointing in Jesus' name. Go out with anointing. Go out with power. Go out with the mantle of the Spirit of God. There's glory upon your life already. Don't compromise. Don't fall. Don't look back. The Lord will go with you. Even your anchorship, coming upon the sick, eventually will heal the sick. And your garment coming upon the demonized will cast those demons out in Jesus' name. It has happened to me. It will happen to you. I said it will happen to you. Can I give you a little testimony? You're in a hurry? Because I'm telling you something that will happen to you. They took my clothes. I don't have too many. But they took my clothes to the people dry cleaning. And the dry cleaner was sick with a particular sickness. And then he put my clothes in water. And by the time he finished washing my clothes, he became well. It's coming to you. I said it's coming to you. Power will clothe you. Anointing will clothe you. Leave the mantles of the world and let us put on the mantle of the anointed, and great will be the power in your life in Jesus' name. Rise up and talk to the Lord and recommit your life to the Lord. Recommit your body to the Lord. Recommit yourself in consecration unto the Lord. Greater anointing, a new mantle coming upon your life. Your own time has come. The blessing of God will multiply in your life. Don't be like the world. Be like Mordecai and take your stand, and the anointing will multiply in your life.